A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. I am reminding you, brothers and sisters, of the gospel I preached to you, which you indeed received, and in which you also stand. Through it you are also being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I handed on to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accord with the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accord with the Scriptures, that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. After that, he appeared to more than 500 brothers at once, most of whom are still living, though some have fallen asleep. After that, he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one born abnormally, he appeared to me, for I am the least of the apostles, not fit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace to me has not been ineffective. Indeed, I have toiled harder than all of them. Not I, however, but the grace of God that is with me. Therefore, whether it be I or they, so we preach, and so you believed. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. Let the house of Israel say, his mercy endures forever.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
The right hand of the Lord is exalted. The right hand of the Lord has struck with power. I shall not die but live and declare the works of the Lord.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
You are my God, and I give thanks to you. O my God, I extol you. Give thanks
to the Lord, for he is good. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Luke. A certain Pharisee invited Jesus to dine with him, and he entered the Pharisee's house and reclined at table. Now there was a sinful woman in the city who learned that he was at table in the house of the Pharisee. Bringing an alabaster flask of ointment, she stood behind him at his feet, weeping, and began to bathe his feet with her tears. Then she wiped them with her hair, kissed them, and anointed them with the ointment. When the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he said to himself, "If this man were a prophet, he would know who and what sort of woman this is who is touching him, that she's a sinner." Jesus said to him in reply, "Simon, I have something to say to you." "Tell me, teacher," he said. "Two people were in debt to a certain creditor. One owed 500 days' wages, the other owed 50. Since they were unable to repay the debt, he forgave it for both. Which of them will love him more?" Simon said in reply, "The one, I suppose, whose large debt was forgiven." He said to him, "You have judged rightly." Then he turned to the woman and said to Simon, "Do you see this woman? When I entered your house, you did not give me water for my feet, but she has bathed them with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You did not give me a kiss, but she has not ceased kissing my feet since the time I entered. You did not anoint my head with oil, but she anointed my feet with ointment. So I tell you, her many sins have been forgiven. Hence, she has shown great love. But the one to whom little is forgiven loves little. He said to her, "Your sins are forgiven." The others at table said to themselves, "Who is this who even forgives sins?" But he said to the woman, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace." The Gospel of the Lord. I got all kinds of fantasies, I suppose, when it comes to putting myself in the scene of some of these scripture passages. But this one here, this is my fantasy, that in fact, this is the woman caught in the act of adultery that you can read about in John's Gospel chapter 8. And I can say that with a little bit more confidence than just my fantasy, because we know for a fact that that story is not an original part of John's Gospel at all. And in fact, it can be found in various places, including at the end of John's Gospel and in Luke's Gospel. So we know it's a story that was kind of freewheeling, and it makes sense to me, as much as she was forgiven, as much mercy as was shown her in that scene, that she would be somebody who, like this woman here, loved much and was so grateful. So what's the point? For us, the point is that we have the knowledge of being forgiven. Love forgives us. We have the knowledge of being forgiven, and therefore our response is a response of love as well. That's important for us. And why can we validate that? St. Paul tells us very clearly, because of the resurrection. We know that Jesus, risen from the dead, therefore does have the power and the authority to pronounce forgiveness of sins in this way. Who can forgive sins but God alone? Well, there's your answer. There's your answer. It's exactly who it is that's forgiving us. So our mercy that we receive should, pardon that word, should engender in us a loving response of gratitude. And we know that in Jesus Christ, risen from the dead, in the sacrament of the Eucharist, in the joy of the gospel, we have the opportunity of being grateful and filled with love as well. So we give thanks to God for that promise of forgiveness. Let us stand and pray.